Chapter 4 deals with body membranes and the skin. We talked about epithelial tissue primarily being the making up the membranes in our body, but however, we're going to see there is an exception to that. But nonetheless, body membranes are primarily epithelial in nature. So we're going to look at the membranes, and then we're going to look at our first actual system that we've talked about so far, which will be our integumentary system, which will make up the skin section of this. And it's kind of unique because the integument and integumentary system are really two things in one. They are both in a system and an organ, kind of like the continent and country of Australia are both a continent and a country. So sometimes things can be two things in one, and that's what we see in the nature of the integument or the skin. But first, let's start out with our body membranes, and notice that here are our functions. What is it that our membranes are doing for us, and our skin doing some of this, our skin actually functioning as one of our membranes called the integumentary membrane, or the cutaneous membrane, I should say. All right, so first of all, well, membranes line and cover our surfaces, so that means they're going to have a free end on one side surrounding either a lumen or being a surface where there's space outside of the membrane. They're going to protect whatever's under the membrane, and they're going to create a lubricant for whatever is under the membrane. So the cells in there will secrete some sort of secretion, such as mucus or some sort of surfactant. Okay, as we were saying, most membranes are actually epithelial. So here we see epithelial membranes, and the epithelial membranes are the cutaneous membrane, which is basically the skin, the mucous membrane, the membrane that lines every entrance and exit to the body, and the serous membrane, which is basically what we see lining the lungs and the heart. Then we do have an exception to our epithelial membranes in our connective tissue membrane. So remember, epithelium and connective tissue are two of our four tissues. So we'll be looking at each of these and talking a little bit more about that. So a picture is worth a thousand words. So this picture is something you probably need to know. So let's go ahead and look at it. Here are our four membranes: the mucous membrane, the serous membrane, the cutaneous membrane, and all those are epithelial membranes. And then here is our connective tissue membrane, the synovial membrane. So let's take each of these individually and look at the characteristics. Now notice here's our picture. So we have like samples of a mucous membrane, and our sample here happens to be our alimentary canal of our digestive system. In other words, the opening and exit where food comes in and waste goes out, it's going to be lined by a mucous membrane, but so would all the other openings and exits to the body, such as the respiratory tract or the urinary or tract, or even the space going into the ear area would have a variation of this. But let's look at the characteristics of the mucous membrane, and notice that if we look at these cells right here, we see that they're epithelial. And in this case, they look to be simple columnar epitheliums that are ciliated. So, and actually, if this were lining our trachea area, then that would be ciliated. But since this is actually alluding to lining our intestines, then instead of being ciliated, these would be microvilli, which would increase the absorption of the food. Now, this right here is called a goblet cell, and its job is actually to produce the mucus secretion. And the mucus secretion does several things, but one of the main things in the digestive system is it creates a smoother path for the food, which at this point would be called chyme, to travel through the digestive system. And it also basically keeps the cells from drying out, preserving them longer. All right, now notice here's our basement membrane down here, which is going to connect the epithelial tissue to some connective tissue here, the areolar tissue, which is our most widely spread connective tissue, and usually the connective tissue that is attached to a basement membrane and connecting it to other connective tissues. Notice our vascularity of our connective tissue, because this is a vein and artery, whereas remember our epithelial tissue is always avascular. So anyway, these are some characteristics that we'd see in our mucous membranes. Again, the membranes that line our entrances and exits to our body. Our next membrane, it notices a thinner membrane, at least for the epithelial part. The mesothelium here, the epithelial portion, is going to be simple squamous epithelial cells. And again, they're going to have a basement membrane attached to some more areolar tissue. But this membrane is what we're going to see lining our pleural cavities, the pleural membranes, and also the pericardium around the heart. And there's a fluid, because this is usually a double membrane. It actually has two sides with a space between it. And in the space, we're going to actually have a fluid that basically is called transudate. And that's going to keep the two sides of the membranes from rubbing together and creating too much friction. We'll talk more about this when we get to the individual membranes, when we talk about them in context of the systems. But right now we're looking at the general characteristic of all of them. All right, our third epithelial tissue is our cutaneous membrane, and basically that's our skin. And it's our skin minus the what we call accessory structures. So it's the epithelial, areolar, and other connective tissues like our dents or regular, which makes up our deep dermis. All right, so looking at this, we can see here's our stratified squamous. We can see our cells flatten out as they get pushed up further, and then we wash those cells away, or they fall off of us through time. So we have to keep replacing them with our stem cell layer, which is down here. Again, our basement membrane would be in this area here where we connect the epithelium to the areolar tissue. Again, we see our vascularity and the connective tissue, that because we have to, we're avascular in the epithelium, but we do have to get the contents from the blood there, so we diffuse the products through the tissues to those cells. But eventually, the cells die as they go further up. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a couple of minutes. All right, and then here's our dense irregular connective tissue, meaning that it's densely packed, but the fibers are running at all different angles, which gives it more pliability. But again, notice this is a section of our skin here, and so it's not just epithelial, but it is primarily epithelial. Like this is epithelial and this is epithelial, but they do have some connective tissue in them. Now, our last type of membrane, a lining area, is our synovial membrane, and this is actually going to be our connective tissue membrane. Notice we have the end of the femur there and the top of the tibia, and that they are connected by this connective tissue here. And if we blow that up and look at it, what we see is that they've actually gotten in quotation marks epithelium, because it's not truly epithelium, but it is cells that basically control what leaves the blood and actually becomes the synovial fluid, because the synovial fluid is going to be here in the space between the actual membrane and the cartilage of the bone. So, we have that lubricating synovial fluid. We kind of alluded to when we talked about where is water in the body, and we know amniotic fluid or synovial fluid or cerebrospinal fluid were all fluids that are derived from our blood, because we see the vascularity here of the membrane. And when the contents of the blood leak out, these epithelial cells kind of control what actually leaves to become the synovial fluid. So they kind of like make the synovial fluid out of the blood. We have a few other cells in this tissue, but again, this is all connective tissue, even though we kind of call these cells in parentheses epithelium, even though they're not true epithelial cells, but they kind of serve the same purpose of the epithelial cells. They're lining this cavity filled with fluid, but they take on the extra job of actually kind of controlling the fluid that actually goes across them to become the synovial fluid. So if you ever have an injury in one of these areas, you tend to have swelling because you build up that fluid. And anytime you have an injury or some sort of inflammation process. It's because you get an increased blood flow to the area, and so therefore you get increased fluid from the blood flow to the area. But so obviously you can build up too much synovial fluid, making it very comfortable and painful, uncomfortable and painful. But we have to have a certain amount to keep the bones from rubbing together, to keep it lubricated. So these are, again, our four different membranes. The first three being epithelial. We see the characteristics of the epithelial cells inside of the membranes. These all line areas, and these are all important to the body and keep us safe. They protect what's under it. They make sure everything has a lubricated surface, especially the mucus secretions and the transudate and the synovial fluid. Okay, a little more specific, the serous membrane, as we said, going from this particular type of membrane here to what we see here. Well, actually, I mentioned the pleura, which is the membrane around the lungs, and I mentioned the pericardium, but I did fail to mention the peritoneum, which is the membrane that actually covers your abdominal cavity. So if you ever had to have surgery, say your appendix taken out or something, they would have to cut through that membrane to get down into the actual organs. So, and matter of fact, the one thing that's happens in serous appendicitis where it ruptures is it actually infects this membrane. Now, when I said earlier that this was a double membrane, so we had to have the fluid between the membranes, this picture is an example. Whether it is the pericardium surrounding a lung, or excuse me, the heart, so imagine the fist is the heart, or the pleura surrounding a lung, notice that there's a side here and there's a side there, and then I have space between it. Well, to keep this side from rubbing against that side, even though it's really one continuous membrane, then we have a fluid here and it keeps them from creating too much friction rubbing together. Now, the portion of the membrane that actually adheres to the organ, whether that be the heart or the lungs, is the parietal part of the membrane, and the portion of the, excuse me, is the visceral part of the membrane, and the portion that is outside is the parietal part of the membrane. So you'll see the terms visceral, viscera meaning organ, being anything next to the organ, parietal meaning away from the organ, and in the case of the pleura and the pericardium, the parietal, especially from the pleura, actually adheres to the back of the body wall. Okay, now to our first system, our integumentary system, which is really made up of the cutaneous membrane that we actually looked at back here, the cutaneous membrane right here. But what else it has besides that is what we call our accessory structures, or here they call it skin derivatives, such as our sweat glands, oil glands, hair, nails, and structures that's not necessarily just the epithelial or connective tissues. So looking at that, let's look at a section here. Notice that I've got my epidermis and my dermis. So the epidermis and the dermis basically are going to make up the cutaneous membrane. But all these structures we see in here, such as the hair, the nerve endings, which notice there's a nerve ending there, nerve ending here, a nerve ending here, Meissner's corpuscle, the Pacinian corpuscle, the free nerve endings that we see here, the encapsulated nerve endings actually are detecting different pressure. So the Meissner's is going to detect a lighter pressure because it's closer to the surface. The Pacinian is going to detect a heavier pressure because it's further away. The free nerve endings, these nerve endings that run out here that don't really have some sort of encapsulated area, they're called nociceptors, and they're either going to be detecting things like pain or things like heat and cold. So you have different densities of nerve endings in different areas of your skin, and we know that because we know some areas of our skin are much more sensitive than other areas and have many more nerve endings actually in them. All right, so hair follicles, sweat glands, oil glands. We have these sebaceous glands that keep the hair follicles with oil to keep them from becoming too brittle and snapping off. We have the sweat glands that help us go through.